we get to that famous court case, Nisho Iwai, or the first sale rule. So, Nisho Iwai pretty much was the groundbreaker first sale. And I was and this is a relatively new edition, because as I was looking through the for the updates through the chart, I came across the customs broker exam question, which only made sense if you apply the first sale rule. But the first sale rule is a very politically challenged point, and the first sale rule is something which is something which customs themselves wanted to get rid of. They did not survive the political entangle, so I think they posted the proposed rulemaking, but there was such an opposition that they decided to abandon it. So first sale rule is still very much alive today, but I think what we need to do here is to bring to your attention this very, very famous case, which also has roots over here in New York. So let me pull it up. Think I okay, yes, that's it. So that's there are very expensive paid search engines, but this one is available free, and I'm known to use it on frequent basis. The Google Scholar, they improved over the years. So what does this case describe? So MTA, Metropolitan New York City MTA, Metropolitan Transit Authority, runs a subway system. I think it's the biggest in the world. And for subway systems, they need to use train cars. Those train cars, if you are ever in New York, I would highly recommend, or if you live or visiting, I would highly recommend to go to the New York City Transit Museum, because they have a historic compilation of all various train cars, which have been changing throughout the years, going back to the late 1900s, and 19th century, I'm sorry, late 1800s. It's quite an amazing sight. Still today, if you take a trip at the subway, you have the train cars, which are like 40 years old and are still running, still functioning. And those are made, I think, either domestically or in Canada. Some of them are made elsewhere. But the story is about those train cars, which MTA decided to buy in a bulk load. And of course, those train cars are very expensive. So the issue went as follows. Well, before we get to the issue, let's talk about the transaction. So we have MTA here, right? So Japanese manufacturer makes those train cars, right? MTA of New York City wants those train cars. So they contact the manufacturer, but they do not contact them through the direct means. What they do is they go through the middle person. There is a company one, or I say company one, which is owned by company two. MTA goes to company one and asks for those train cars. The company one goes to those to the Japanese manufacturer and buys those train cars. Then it sells the rights to the company two, which owns company one. So here we have middle person, or persons rather. So the price for let's say the price is X for one train car, but the price between manufacturer and the middle person is X minus one. So here is a scheme that took place in Nisho Iwai to drive the point home and to make a point that there is several parties, four parties that are involved in the transaction. So the question is, at which point do you declare the price? Do you declare the price at this point, or you declare the price at this point? Is it X or X minus one, which is substantially lesser, right? So of course MTA, although it is a, it's not a state instrumentality, it's not, or even it's a city instrumentality, but to not pay taxes, you have to be a federal government, right? Here we have a city government, so they have to pay duties and taxes. So they're obviously interested in declaring X minus one because it's a lower value, so they pay lesser duties. This is how it came about. So the fight was, okay, is it X minus one or X, which we must pay in order to, which is a transaction value which we must pay that would qualify for the declaration purposes. So the court, to make the long story short, says as long as you meet certain criteria, which means you have to, it has to be for export to United States, and it has to be arm's length if you meet this criteria, then you're good, because arm's length means that there is no relationship between these guys and these guys, and for export means that those train cars are specifically made to go to MTA. They cannot go anywhere else. They're not like general purpose goods, because there is, whenever MTA orders those train cars, they have specifications, because they have various length for the tracks. My understanding is there are for the subway system there are two types of different lengths. Like in Manhattan there is one type of train car, in Brooklyn, Queens, there is another type of train car, and as far as tracks length is concerned, specifications, air conditioning, the length, the service, the warranty, all this stuff, they're very specific to the MTA. So it's not like they can take the train cars and say, okay, MTA, you don't want them, so we'll take them to India or something. No. They are specifically made for export to the United States. There is no question about that. So the court said, all right, so you can use this price. You can use X minus one price for this particular transaction because you meet this criteria. So MTA ended up paying lower duties for their train cars than it would otherwise have to if they use the contract price between the middle person and MTA as opposed to Japanese manufacturer and the middle person. So this is a caveat which we're talking about here. Now, so the link is here. If you are curious, you're welcome to read through this. But let's go back to the outline and see why this concept is so important and how it broke out in the licensed customs broker exam. So, So let's take a look. The Cleveland Lock Corporation. So we have Cleveland Lock. Has placed an order from the unrelated padlock vendor, Fleur de Lis Locks. FLL. Of Montreal, Canada. So I assume this is United States. This is Canada. All right. Fleur de Lis Locks has agreed to sell the locks at United States 510. So the FOB Montreal. FOB Montreal is 510. Fleur de Lis Locks, however, contracts the Sécurité Ltee, a producer of locks also located in Montreal, so also in Canada. Let's call it SL. A producer of locks, so Sécurité sells this products arm's length. So recall, there is a, must be done for export to the United States and arm's length according to the Nishevai case. This is the criteria of the first sale rule. So, then we go. Sécurité sells the product at arm's length to Fleur de Lis. So they sell the locks. So orders placed. CL places order with FLL. FLL makes an order from SL, right? And this sale over here is 510. And the sale over here is 375. And ships the locks directly to Cleveland. So they are definitely made for export. The locks are definitely made for export to the United States. So we have arm's length plus for export to US. Equals first sale rule. All right, so we have that criteria over here outlined, right? All right, great. So we have first sale rule outlined. So if we have first sale, that means we can use this price instead of this price, right? So it's this price which is relevant. Now, this is the analytical point so far. Let's read on. The record shows that FLL, right? At no charge to Sécurité, provided certain Canadian-made retail packaging bearing Cleveland Locks name and mark. The value of packaging is $20, 20 cents each. Now, recall the assist. Assist is providing value of those components at free of charge, no cost, right? It is part. It becomes part of the value, right? So you have to add 20 cents, which means the price now is $3.95 because it's in addition to the price actually paid or payable under the transaction value. Sorry, it's not an assist because assist has to be provided by the buyer. But if you look at the transaction value discussion under part 152, section 152, 102 tells you that the cost of packaging material is in addition to the transaction value, to the price actually paid or payable. So we cannot disregard that, we have to add it. But we have to add it over here because this is the value we're concerned in under fair sale rule. All right, so let's keep on reading. After being informed by SL that locks includes a total of 1.75 each of non-originating materials, so we have non-originating materials, let's use the standard, the value of non-originating materials is 175. Exporter FLL completes NAFTA certificate of origin for the benefit of the customer. So we're good. Form 434 must be made by the exporter. So far we're in compliance. Now here is something interesting happening. The instant locks are classified and they're providing us the classification, but the customs examiners go beyond that. They also provide us the rules, so we do not need to go to the general note 12 and look it on our own, so we can save some time. So they're stating that under this for this particular rule, we must have the following stuff. A change to subheading 83.110 through 83.50 from any other chapter. All right. Or a change to subheading 83.110 from subheading 83.160, whether or not there is also a change from any other chapter, provided that the original value content is the following. All right. So now the question comes down to. Just a moment. So the question is there a change based upon solid information? Which of the following statement is correct? Based on this, we have to figure out, is A applicable first or B is applicable, right? Well, looking at the fact pattern above, right? So here we're not able to tell where the originating material comes from, but we know that there is non-originating material, right? Because we do not know which non-originating material takes place, right? Because customs examiners not tell and asking us to use solely upon information provided, we cannot conclude that this is the final point of analysis, because we do not know which parts are non-originating materials, right? Because you have to have that. Remember that copper wire example. We have to have that tariff shift, right? Is there tariff shift or not? We don't know. So here, customs examiners are implying that if that is not known, then you must keep on going. All right. So the next rule says a change to subheadings 8310, because we have OR provision, through 85 from subheading 8310, whether or not there is also change from any other chapter, provided there is original value content of not less than 60% of the transaction value method is used, or 50% where the net cost method is used. All right, so we here dealing with the transaction value, not with the net cost value, because we are given the FOB price, right, which is a transaction length. We know it's arm's length, right, and we know it's for export. So we are using this formula right here. So original value content must be 60%, right? So what we're going to do is we're going to plug in the numbers, right? Transaction value for the product, because it missed the first sale, it's not 510, it's 395. So 395 minus VNM, right? Which is 175, according to CBP examiners, divided by 395, and we have to multiply it by 100. So okay, so let's do it. I have a calculator here, so 395 minus 175 is 2.2 divided by 3.95 is 0.556962 times 100. Well, yeah, I just should move the dots. 55.69. So this is the RVC and the transaction value. But we must have 60%, not less than 60% of the transaction value. So the question is, does it qualify? And looks like 5569 is the answer that no, it does not qualify. So after this, performing these analytical checks, we are ready to dive in into the into the answer choices, right? So let's take a look. All right, so we have the following. Based solely upon the information provided, okay, we know that the law qualifies as originating. Looks like it doesn't, so we can skip that. The law qualifies as originating under transaction value method as original RVC is 65.69%. We have 55.69, so B is not our choice, right? The log fails to qualify as originating. So we know it fails to qualify, so we can exclude A, B, and E right away, right? Because it doesn't qualify. So D and C are really the battlegrounds. And it comes down to the percentages. And the percentages, the only way you can derive it is if you understand the first sale rule and you plug these numbers in. So we know that 55.69 is our choice. And we have 53.33 and 55.70. Well, I think if you guys watch the rounding of fractions, I think it can be fairly say that it can be rounded to 55.70. So if you round it up, 55.70 would be D, not C. So 34, this number, and only this number helps us to answer this answer choice D. Here is the problem though, folks. You can't, it's almost impossible to answer this without knowing the first sale rule. So to me, it came as a surprise. But at the same time, I kind of like this idea because examiners really raise the threshold for the, keep on raising the bar for your threshold of knowledge. And it's not even the point where you have to know just the regulations, but you also have to understand the case law which clarifies those regulations from the real world. So that's an exciting part, and it's really what makes it exciting to teach stuff like this, because it's continuous challenge to make this course a successful course. And it is questions like this that really make the day go around. Of course, other questions are important, but this analytical stuff is really what's what comes as a challenging point for many, and to overcome this challenge can be a lot of fun, in my view.